Hi everyone, it's Joe from Vivon Pandoni here with Philip Stevenson, and we're very happy to be with Vic Armstrong, according to the Guinness Book of Records, the most prolific stunt performer in the world. So I guess that would be my first question, Vic. What does it feel like to be the most prolific stunt performer in the world officially?
That's what I always wanted to be, even when I started. You know, I was in it a very young man, had no money, and then started earning money. And I thought, wow, this is great, and I'll try and do this full time. And in those days, stuntmen were just part-time players, and they'd have a news agent or some other occupation to fill in between films. And I thought, wow, I'll try and make a business of this. And the more it started, the more it went. And so I thought, well, I'm a workaholic, so I'm quite proud to be called the most prolific, which means I work the most.
Yeah.
So I'm very happy with that.
So how did you, going right back to the beginning, how did you get into it, and rather than working 9 to 5 in an office or something?
I don't think I was ever destined to be a 9 to 5 person. My dad and my mother were quite adventurous people. When I was 9, they sold up everything and moved out to Africa, which was in the mid-50s, which I always thought was an amazingly brave thing to do with. I was 9-ish, probably 8, just nearly 9. My sister was 11, and my little Andy, my brother, was 18 months. To take the whole family and go out to Kenya. Sadly, when they got there, it was a disaster because the woman they were in a partnership with turned out to be an alcoholic, and it all went wrong. And now they've sold everything and we're out there with no jobs. So they had to live in a hotel for 3 months until he got a job up country in Nakuru, training racehorses. So I had a year where I didn't go to school at all. Then we came back and Dad, started building everything up again. So I've had an unusual sort of lifestyle to begin with. And we've moved around a lot, buying houses, selling them, trying to improve, getting some money. And all I ever wanted to do was be a steeplechase jockey, because my dad was, first love was racehorse training. So I started racing actually when I was 14 years old, my first race. And that's all I ever wanted to do. But then I'm quite large, so I had to starve myself to death. And then the opportunity came to work on a movie. We had a lot of horses at the time over near Pinewood, and somebody introduced a stuntman to me called Jimmy Lodge, and he wanted to come and ride our horses in the mornings before work for keeping fit. And he was obviously a keen racing man, so he rode with us for a few weeks, and then he started on a movie called Arabesque. And the horses they'd hired on it were absolutely old clodhoppers that couldn't jump out of their own way, and one in fact, they're supposed to jump gates and a big flying chase in this movie. And these horses couldn't even jump, 2 foot. One ran out trying to jump, training it to jump over a little hurdle and broke the stunt woman's leg, hitting the gatepost. So he went completely apeshit and said, look, Vic, can I rent your horse? And I had a very good horse at the time. I rented him the horse. Then they said, well, we need people to ride it as well. So I went along and rode it, and we did this great chase. And I was getting the £20 a day, which is phenomenal. This was in 1965. That was a lot of money, more than a week's wages, really, for most people. I was getting that every day. And I thought, wow, this will do me. And I looked at it as a way of sponsoring my racing, because I was just an amateur. And so I did that. And then I started looking into stunt work a bit more. And I got hold of an agency in London, the Howard Agency. She started giving me some work. And because I was about the only young guy in those days, I would get work quicker, because you line up for an audition and people would come along, and you could be a little 4'6" actor and 5 foot wide and look around and say, I think the young man on the right's perfect double for me. Whatever, give me the money, I'll be there. Anyway, so that's how I started, really, and I've just got a lot of work quickly, and success breeds success, and it just went on from there. And it was just fate. I was very, very lucky to fall into the business,
So from 65 when you started to 67 when you did You Only Live Twice, how did you get onto the Bond set?
It was actually 66 we did You Only Live Twice, because it premiered in 67, but it's always a year before when you're shooting the movies. So 65 I did Arabesque. And then I did a couple little TV shows, terrible little TV things, but it's 15 quid you'd get for a day. I remember one I did, I'd finished by 10 o'clock and they said, that's great, super job. Sent me home and they gave me £7.10 in those days, half wages. But dear Gabby Howard, my agency, jumped all over that and got me the other £7.10. So I did a couple of those, and then I went up for an audition on another Gregory Peck film, Arabesque with Gregory Peck. Went for an audition on another Gregory Peck film called The Bells of Hell Go Ting-a-ling-a-ling. Big, big movie for Mirisch Brothers in Switzerland. And that was in 1966, in the spring of 66. And I went along for an audition for that and met on that same audition a guy for the same job, a guy called Bill Weston, who ended up being one of my greatest friends. He sadly died of cancer. Wonderful, wonderful man. Godfather to my eldest son. And anyway, so I got the job and he didn't, but I gave him a lift to the station. We remained friends ever since. So I went to Switzerland on that. I had a 9-week contract and we worked for about 5 weeks on it and they pulled the plug on the movie. But I was amazed. I got 9 weeks wages. I thought, woohoo, this is great. So I came back to England. That was like midsummer, late summer. And I called Bill just for a chat and talk. And I said, you know, they pulled the plug on the film. You know, I was supposed to be there for months and months. So it didn't happen. And he said, oh, okay. He said, look, I'm on this film with this director. He's just taking for ages and ages. It's never going to finish, he said. And I've got a contract at Pinewood on Bond. And the film he was talking about that he was on was 2001. So he was driving like Kia Delay or something. Anyway, it went on and on and on. So he said, go to Pinewood and tell them you want my contract. So I didn't know what this business was like. So I shot up to Pinewood Studios. And where the 007 stage is now, there was a huge construction, like big as St. Paul's Cathedral, of scaffold tubes and canvas sheets. And so they built outside sets in those days. It was an exterior covering around what was the volcano, the interior of the volcano. And I went up there, walked into the set, and it's like, oh my God, you looked up and had a sliding roof and monorail around it, and you could put, you know, 600,000-700,000 people in there. You could put thousands of people in there. It's huge. Anyway, I went in there and the stunt people were in there and I met two people. One, funnily enough, ended up being my father-in-law, which is Wendy's dad, yeah, George Leakes. And Bob Simmons was the guru of Bond in those days. And he did start really the fight sequences and choreography that I certainly learned very well from. Very, very intelligent, just instinctive fight choreographer. Anyway, I went along to see them and I said, I'm up here, take Bill Weston's job. They went, oh, really? He hasn't actually got the job yet. But anyway, so they talked about it and I was very fit and lean in those days. Power to weight ratio was good. And they pointed up to the sky and there's this sliding roof up there and ropes hanging down, 125 feet. And they said, we need people to slide down those ropes, just holding on with their hands. And you do that? I said, yeah, of course I can, yeah, no problem. In the back of my mind, I'm thinking, no way, Jose. And then that was in the fall of that year. I did 6 weeks on it at £65 a week. Get less because it's on a contract. But I did get a £90 adjustment for sliding down these ropes. I did lots and lots of slides because the same power to weight ratio is good. So I got a £90 what we call stunt adjustment, which is extra for doing something extra dangerous. Bought my first car, which was a Ford Anglia 105E like Harry Potter's got, for £90. It did need tyres on it, and in those days we had supposedly 120 stuntmen plus crowd, but you know, there were taxi drivers and bouncers and villains and all sorts, amongst which there were about 20, 30 key stunt people. Anyway, I'd asked around, I said, I need some tyres for my car, and I went, what sort of car is it? I said, Ford Anglia. They went, oh, can you bring it in? I said, I'll bring it in tomorrow. They said, all right, bring the car in. So I drove in to Pinewood the next day and said to the car, I've got the car. I went, all right. He drove around, he'd rented a Ford Anglia and they swapped the wheels over and I gave him a fiver and off he went. It was that sort of a shoot, it was wonderful. Anyway, so then I was on the Bond and that was, you know, it was incredible. Again, fate is amazing because that was a great networking. You know, there's nothing like meeting people. And you could go for 20 years and not meet as many people as I met in those 6 weeks, you know. Plus the experience of looking at such a vast film and getting, you know, because it's all still very new to me, the stunt business, of getting the feel of what it is like on these massive productions. So that got me onto the Bond and, you know, and then it knocked on from there.
So you're that very iconic set by Ken Adam, the
the volcano, Blowfields Volcano. You're famously the first ninja to jump down, is that true?
There's a picture over there, let's have a look in a minute, yeah.
So what's your favourite memory of
working on? Not necessarily the first through, I used to come down the fastest, because my theory was, we had two methods of coming down the ropes, and the two types of ropes. One was an inch hemp rope, we had hose pipe, which was just under an inch wide, round, just circumference. You slip the hose pipe, wrap it round the rope, right, and you hold that, and you come down, and that's your brake shoe. Right, okay. And that's what I was saying about the power to weight ratio. So I did a lot of those, and my theory on that was, people are a bit nervous, they'd be holding it on their way down, and it's like your car, when brakes get too hot, they stop working. You're far better off just firing down and using all your braking and one hit at the bottom. You get it right, otherwise you do go into the floor. But we used to put talcum powder in these things, so you really took off fast. And I used to pride myself when they said action, you launch yourself off these little girders at the top and then just time it, turn the brakes on, and smoke pours out of this thing and you stop. So I always used to pride myself, I was always competitive, I'd get down first before them. Right. Then there's another method with a piece of equipment called a descendeur. Would you get one for me? It's just over on the wall there. You see those figure eights? Bring that over for us. That's it. It's funny you mentioned that, but so after that, we had to come down one-handed firing a Sterling submachine gun with the other. So they had this machine, which is called a descendeur. It's a French piece of equipment, aluminium. The rope comes down, goes round here, round here, round here, and down to your hand. That's hooked on there, and you're hanging on this rope. And down, you just let the rope go, and it just buzzes round here. And this basically acts like a brake shoe, like the hose pipe did. But now you can do it one-handed, and then with this hand, you're shooting, because this is hooked to your belt. Putting that on. Well, one of our friends was a parachutist, and he went down to somewhere in North Wales to see all his old parachute buddies. They had one of their meetings. And he was very excited to tell him he's working on this Bond film. And he'd taken one of these with him, and he's going to show them, because we'd never seen anything like this. This is sophisticated for us, you know. And so he got up in this little wooden hut where their village hut where they were doing their thing, put a rope round it, hooked onto this, and jumped off and crashed straight through the floor. This snapped here, it had a hairline crack in it. He couldn't wait to get back Monday morning and say, guys, we can't use those. We're coming 125 dry feet with these things. So somebody said, I've heard about this new invention called a figure eight. So I said, wow, that sounds fantastic. And what it is this little fella. And let's get this one off. So this is your figure eight. And this is the original figure eight. This goes on your belt, rope comes through there, around there, and this acts as the brake shoe. But it's looped through there, so it cannot come off. And it comes down. But as you can see, it's very narrow and it's steel. It generates a lot of heat. And when you come down there really fast firing your submachine, and this thing is red hot when you hit the bottom, and if you stand still too long, it almost cuts through the rope like a cheese cutter. Okay. Anyway, we were thrilled to have this. You know, you could almost faint and it'd still get you down. You wouldn't fall off it. But then somebody said, oh no, they've got new ones. And then, so this is how they developed over the years, from that little one to that one to this. And these are old fashioned now. They've got even great bigger ones and things like that. But there you go. That was the Bond. And that little thing earned me £90 for my first car, and my career was flying along.
Did you go from a ninja to James Bond?
Yes, I did. And, you know, in those days, the hierarchy, you know, Connery would come in surrounded by people, and his car would drive into the set, and he'd get in a monorail and drive around to where the set was, and they do. It was like a visit from the Pope. Anyway, so cut to not long later, I was in my dad's stable yard. I got married by then. I'd done Ryan's Daughter and things like that, and I got married in Ryan's Daughter and bought a house in Farnham Common near where my dad's place was. And I used to go and exercise the horses every day, because that was still a big part of my life, racing. I wasn't, you know, working that constantly to not do my racing. And I was walking past the back door one day, and the phone rang, and I went, hello? They said, we're looking for Vic Armstrong. I said, oh, that's me, yeah, yeah. Are you free for 2 weeks? I said, yep, sure, okay, we'll get back to you. Went, great. That night they phoned back, it's okay, now you're on a charter from Gatwick tomorrow at 2:30, da 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 da. And you're going to Switzerland. This, I said, what is it? What's the job? They said, Bond, of course. I went, oh, good. Now, they got my name because I begin with an A. So it wasn't me they were looking for. I just, again, as lucky they went, A, okay, we go. If A wasn't answered, then B would have been, you know. So I went to Gatwick, got on the charter, went out there. And the time we got to Murren, which is the most beautiful place in the Swiss Alps, which I've been back to many times on commemorative things, and I've, there's a plaque for me up on top of the Schilthorn as well, Piz Gloria. Anyway, so I go out there, and it's the most beautiful place I've ever seen in my life, and we go there, and we all meet the next morning, meet the production, meet everybody, and they've been shooting out there for probably 6 months, so I was just a backup lot of people for the second unit, because they'd having a few problems. And they wanted they didn't get a lot of snow, so work was getting compounded, so they wanted to have one separate unit really shooting a lot. So I went out there, and the first thing I said, look, would you mind if you learnt to ski? Because a lot of the locations you can't get to without skiing. And I went, you know, is the Pope a Catholic? Of course I do, yeah. So they taught us to ski. They gave us the Bonnemont passes. You could ski all over the mountains. It was just glorious through there. And I was there for over 3 months instead of the 2 weeks. This went on and on. Ended up doubling Lazenby, who I now play golf with and see quite a lot of. You know, he's very funny. And so, yeah, stayed on that, doubling him, which was absolutely fantastic. And,
the England is up behind.
So I've been back there several times on the 50th anniversary and all those sort of things. And they've got a wonderful, if you ever go there, I thoroughly recommend it. Up on the Piz Gloria.
It's on the bucket list.
Yeah. Oh, it's superb. You go up in the cable car and there's a revolving restaurant and they've got a whole theatre up there and exhibition for Bond. Wendy's dad, who was the stunt coordinator on it, there's a whole article on him. He slid down the rope, you know, on the main unit for Bond. And so... We had wonderful skiers. I'd like to say I did the skiing, but that's obviously that's out of my league. You know, it's some of the greatest skiers in the world doing it. Lucky Leitner, doubling him, and Willy Bogner, the famous Bogner skiwear. He was one of the skiers on it, and he just finished, I think, Grenoble Olympics or something. Where he skied backwards, holding an Ariflex, you know, and so Cubby got hold of him to do the chase ski backwards down the bobsleigh run. Imagine skiing it with a bobsleigh and a little slot, and he went out of the bobsleigh, and the bobsleigh overtook him when it, you know, got to that place. But he also did skiing chases with it. But again, it was a huge, huge learning curve for me. And again, I met many, many people. That's what John Glenn came out to direct the second unit on, because the main unit was just grinding to a halt, and they got rid of them anyway. And John came out. We didn't get any snow. It was the weirdest thing. We'd be on location all week, and it would... It wouldn't snow, it was dreadful. And then Saturday's our day off, we'd all go into Interlaken or somewhere, and it was snow like billy-o. So they said, right, we'll have Sundays off. And so every Sunday we had off, it would snow on a Sunday. And Tuesday off, it'd just snow on a Tuesday. Whatever day we had off, it would snow, but not the rest of the time. Anyway, so John came out, and the weather turned perfect, snowed all the time, and we did some great stuff with him. You know, it was wonderful.
There must be something about snow and Bond films in yourself, because you just said about Her Majesty's Secret Service not snowing, but at the beginning of Tomorrow Never Dies, when you were in the Pyrenees, and it wasn't snowing then, you're having to ship it all in as well.
Yeah, that was the funniest. We went as high as we could, and you know, we didn't know what to do for the opening of that, because the openings are iconic on Bonds. And in the end, I said, well, look, let's just do the biggest shootout you have. Instead of having pistols or rifles, you'll have a jet and fire the jet and blow people up. So that's how that whole thing evolved. And then we found Pellissoud, this place up in the Pyrenees, which was fabulous. And the problem was it snowed, but it was very sunny, and it's supposed to be Afghanistan or somewhere, so we want that grey look. So we shot up until 9 o'clock in the morning, when the sun popped over the hill, and then spent all day rigging. I used to run about 9 cameras on those sort of deals for the explosions, the special effects. We'd lay all the bangs out, we'd pull the cameras down, work the camera out, rehearse. And then from 4 o'clock to about 6, when the sun went down that side of the mountain, we'd shoot that side of it. So we'd do a few blow-ups in the morning, prep all day, then blow the crap out of everything at night, repeat next day. And then we came to work one day and all the mountains were pink. I mean, oh my God, what's going on? And they'd had this this wind from the Sahara, picked up all this red dust, and it's gone all over the mountains. So you'd have these lovely pink slopes, and then you'd have a big white gash in it where a little landslide would start and expose the white snow. But yeah, it worked great. And then of course I did the other one in Chamonix with, that was good, I enjoyed that one. That was a beautiful location, you know, we're just living in Chamonix and you'd fly everywhere and all helicopter work, of course, you'd have to go in those crowded cable cars.
So when you're, oh, sorry.
So after You Only Live Twice, another change in Bond, you'd already worked with Sean, you already worked with George, now it's Roger, and you famously double for him in that very iconic scene, the shark pool, Kananga shark pool. What was that like doing that?
Again, a huge learning curve for me. Bob Simmons was the stunt coordinator and I was very, very privileged to have about 3 or 4 weeks just fight rehearsal, which I'd never, you know, had the luxury of that before. But Bob, you know, he was just instinctive. He knew how to set things up, and he quite rightly so. Nowadays, it's par for the course. That's what you do. But I went there and he was working out this fight sequence because Yaphet Kotto was Kanga, whatever his name is. And I was doubling Bond, and then we had another young lady doubling Sapphire, I think it was. And so we worked out all the fight post Bond being released from this thing, because the story is we're tied up on this little platform that takes us up hanging above the sharks, and they're going to dunk us in the sharks and we get eaten unless we do something. Bond's got his amazing watch, which just happened to have this twirling knobble on the end of it. I cut myself free, and I do a handstand on this platform. It's just a platform with a bar over the top. I do a handstand over here and just swing round and jump, land on the ground. Well, we just tested above the ground, where I'd swing around and land on, you know, my feet would hit the crash pad. And then we come to shoot the darn thing, and it's up now 15 feet in the air, and I swung round. But this time I weight go all the way round, and the extra weight of the momentum pulled this thing, and the welding gave, so it went like that. So I dropped another 2 feet and smashed my heels into the ground at full bore. So anyway, I managed to bluff my way through it that day and filled up with painkillers. I went into the toilets actually in Pine, I'll never forget, and got all the toilet paper I could, rolled it up, put it under my insteps, so my heels were off the ground. They were so painful. I cracked the heels. And anyway, so I finished it and got through the fight and everything. But I learned an awful lot of fight choreography on that, because I'd see the way Bob Simmons was working these fights out and looking at angles and this and that. And then, of course, I did my stunt and the first unit are there. And prior to him getting the gas pellet put in his mouth and blowing him up, he does a big fight with Bond. And I'd always admired the fight they did on From Russia With Love in that train carriage. I still think it's one of the best fights in a confined space. When you think how long ago that was, it's very, very ingenious. And so I was watching Bob doing this and then advising the director where he shot over here, and then don't worry about that bit because when you come around here, you'll be able to see his face or whatever, you know. So again, great learning curve. And I've always been creative. And I was really bitten by the bug of how you create these fights and create the illusion of what's going on. And it was fascinating to me. And you don't realize at the time, you know, you're like a sponge, though. Everything keeps going in, goes in, and goes in. And I guess if it's what you want to do, you automatically program it, you know? Yeah.
Do you find that Bob Simmons' style was different to George Leach's style? And you've just said you're a sponge and you've nicked things from them. Have you passed that on to other stunt performers going forward?
I think I've copied their styles, and they both had a similar style. It was your classic John Wayne style, which still stands today. The cheats and the things you do, but I think it was much more... It was much more realistic and much more original, because you had to do everything in camera. Yeah. You couldn't cheat and have wires. We could have wires assisting. We used to have jerk backs and things like that. But everything you shot, you set up, you first set it up as though the camera's going to see everything in here. So you work your action around that until, you know, you have to find some way of cheating and maybe moving a pad out of shot or get an angle where you lose the pad. But no, I like to think I still shoot the way they did. And I watch a lot of movies and I worked obviously with a lot of directors, and I've done, as I was with the stunt coordinators and second unit directors, Mickey Moore and people like that, and John Glenn. Mickey Moore is one of the greatest in the world. I watch what they're doing and I watch what directors are doing. I've been lucky enough with Spielberg and Scorsese and Paul Verhoeven and, you know, some great directors. And each one is different. They've got their own way, but you can see the way they get into their end result. So I've learnt probably more diverse stuff from directors than probably the stunt coordinators. I think that is still pretty, not basic, but more standard and more of a solid base. Whereas directors, maybe because of the equipment we're using nowadays, in as much as cranes and drones and all sorts of things, and dollies, but it's still wonderful to see the way they can get creative over. I used to watch Spielberg, like an Empire of the Sun. I'd get there in the morning and I know what the sequence is going to be, or War of the Worlds, I know what the sequence is going to be. And you always imagine, how would I shoot this? Okay, I know he has to come and he has to meet him and have to talk about something, and then they both have to leave, but they've got to go out that door. So, you know the crux of the story, and see in your mind, you're going to do this. And Spielberg would come in and look at it for 10, 15 minutes and do everything on one move on a crane, you know, and you think, oh, wow, yeah, no, well, that's cool, yeah. So, you know, you learn a lot from doing that, you know. I love it.
So on to 1983, Never Say Never Again. So famously, it's not an Eon Bomb film. Sean came back, supposedly, maybe to get one over Cubby. We don't know. You'd been on a few Eon Bomb films. Were there any eyebrows raised about you doing this non-Eon Bomb film?
They were mortified.
Okay.
I was on one of the ones I did with Pierce Brosnan. We were in a production meeting or somewhere, and I said something, and then Barbara Broccoli said, "Don't ever swear like that again in front of me." I went, oh, she said, "Don't ever swear by mentioning that name of that film." I'd mentioned it.
Right, okay.
Or something, just inadvertently, and she was livid. I never did mention it again either. No, that was very much frowned upon.
But you did come back to Eon Bond. So
they forgave couldn't me, bless
you. Yeah, they forgave
and
you.
And they've been wonderful, I've got to say. It's one of the, you could not get a nicer environment to work in, or a better franchise, or more support from a production. They're just fabulous. It's, you know, they're absolutely wonderful. You can't beat it. It's a golden key as well. You go anywhere in the world, you can do what you want, where you want. You know? And so I've got to places that you'd get thrown out on any other movie here. They welcome you with open arms, you know, and they're absolutely fabulous. You couldn't say enough good things about them. And Barbara Broccoli and Michael Wilson are just absolutely glorious, just fabulous people.
So you've worked with all six Bonds in various different guises, not just Bond, but you worked with Timothy Dalton on Flash Gordon, and you worked with...
broke my shoulder doubling Timothy Dalton on Mary Queen of Scots.
Oh, oh really?
Back in the 70s, yeah.
And you worked with Daniel Craig on Golden Compass.
Oh, well done, you know. Yeah. Oh,
a little bit. What are they all like to work with, the six boys?
Everyone is different. Every single one is different. Connery is Connery. He's very regal, if you like, and very direct and to the point. Good sense of humour, very dry, very, very dry, but very iconic. I still think he's the iconic Bond for me. He's great. Roger is wonderful. He's absolutely one of the boys. Great sense of humour. Doesn't take himself or anything else seriously, but does work very seriously. You know, he pretends he's not, he's playing around, but he's actually a very, very studious worker, was. George Lazenby is George Lazenby, and he hasn't changed to this day.
No, I see
him regularly, and he's a crazy man. You're sitting there wondering what he's going to say next.
Rough and ready Aussie.
Yeah. Well, but a wonderful character, but completely different from the others.
Yeah.
And Timothy is more, not introverted, but more of a thespian thinking, I think, maybe, than the others. Lovely guy, and I've done Penny Dreadful with him and stuff like that. You know, spent a lot of time with him. Lovely man, and he lives very close to me in LA. Lovely man, but he's more of a I don't know, an actor's bond or something. I don't know how he'd describe it. Not the others aren't actors, because they are. They play the parts beautifully. And then Pierce is wonderful. He's got a lovely Irish sense of humour, and he trusts you, and very little ego. Just wonderful, you know, because on the bonds now with working with him, I've obviously gone from 65 quid a week on you only live twice, being a ninja sliding down a rope. I've now, you know, my unit's cost over 20 million probably, at least, to run on the show, and I've got 4, 5, 6, 9 cameras on some things. Big old unit running, and I shoot, you know, I'm part of the choreography and the creation of the sequences and everything else, and I go out and shoot them, and when I was in Chamonix, I'd fly home every night from Chamonix to edit the, not every night, every Saturday, I'd fly home to edit the boat chase, and then fly home on a Sunday, fly home to Chamonix on a Sunday to shoot on the Mondays. So I'm very hands-on with all of that sort of stuff. So when Pierce then comes to my unit, I've got my edited version on tape from my video assist of the sequence I'm shooting, and I'd have the plugs where I want him to be in and where he has to react to and all that. And he'd come in the trailer and he's all happy to be with us because it's much more relaxed than my unit. And I was doing something, he said, "Oh, Vic, you're always so enthusiastic." And I said, "Well, I guess that's because I love it. You know, I do enjoy the job." And he said, "Absolutely." And he's just a great, great fun man to be around. And on the boat chase, when I was up at doing the end of the boat chase, I had to put all his close-ups in, which are incredible, mind you. You know, where he's going along, the water splashes. Scared me to death once, though, because he hung over the bridge. Had a specific arch we go through, and I've got the flying cam, which is a little helicopter. In pre-drone days, this is. It's an Ariflex with a helicopter built around it. And incredible operators. We had a landing pad on a boat, so we could land it in mid-Thames. And I started the shot on a real helicopter down around the Houses of Parliament, down towards Hungerford Bridge, and then we do a little editorial cut and swap to this mini helicopter, and so you think the same helicopter's going under the bridge and everything and on Pierce. And we counted the arches where you go through, because there's shallow water on some, and some are a bit sloppier with the water as the tidal hits it. So I said, "You could go through this third one." Yeah. So we do the shot, and we're round and round and round. I'm watching from my monitor on my boat up front, and I'm waiting for him to appear. And he didn't appear. I thought, "Oh my God, he's smashed into the pillar." And then he came out over there. He got the wrong pillar. But great fun. And then the last day shooting, we were on the up at the dome, and they said, "Look, Pierce has to leave at 3 o'clock. He's flying to Ireland and all this sort of stuff." I went, "Oh, okay. And we got to lunchtime. I said, "Pierce, if we crack on through lunch, you know, we're finished and then you're done. You know, if we break now and come back, it's going to be tight getting your end date to get you back to the airport." He said, "That's right, let's work on through. So we finish, shot, done, we've wrapped. So we jumped on the big Sunseeker, and a wonderful guy that just runs the river he manages all the garbage boats and everything. And he's just wonderful. Levitt, his name is, just an incredible guy. Anyway, he's with us and he said, "John, we go down to the restaurant by Tower Bridge, famous restaurant, coming over it, right next to Tower Bridge. So we'll have lunch there." So, "Oh, that'd be good." Okay, so this Sunseeker stood on its tail, just down the Thames, full bore. And I'm looking, and we're going past police boats, and Chris Levitt's just waving to the police. And I go, "Oh, okay. Didn't matter." And he's pointing to Pierce, you know, James Bond. "Yeah, go, Bond." Went all the way down to this restaurant. Pull up outside the restaurant, go in there, and he's got tables, about 8 or 10 of us in there. So, so much from being at the airport at 3, we were still in there at 5:30, 6 o'clock that evening. It was just great. But that's Pierce. He's just a wonderful character, you know.
We asked Gary Powell this question. Be interesting to see if you answer the same or differently. The most impressive Bond stunt ever in the series, in your opinion?
I think the most iconic that I remember, and I remember cheering when I saw it, and I was in Israel and I saw it, is the parachute.
He said the same.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah. Wonderful. I was literally, I don't know, it was some little old movie in Israel, might have been Rambo, don't know what it was. And when that happened, it was like, whoa, it was just, and we'd never seen anything like that. You know, base jumping was sort of a new thing. I liked it so much. In fact, when I was doing my one in Chamonix with the flying machines, you know, picture one over there somewhere, these flying machines chasing, Bond comes right, he sucker punches them in. He goes right at the edge of this crevasse, of this cliff edge, and skids to a halt, and the thing's chasing him. It's, oh my God, it's now on the ground. And this is before they've been flying, because they're like skidoo thingies, yeah. Which copied off a thing I did on Bear Island in the 70s, this Swedish machine with a fan blade behind it. So it was a mishmash of a skidoo with this airboat thing on it. Anyway, he falls over this little ledge, and this thing goes over the edge, and that's the end of the Russian, you think, you know? And then he looks, and it goes down, and pop, parachute comes out, and comes back up, and the chase is on again. You know, it's a great moment. But my pitch at the time, because, you know, all those ideas, we all pitch ideas, and my pitch was, the parachute opens up, and you had it's a black parachute, and you had a red hammer and sickle on it, you know, as an homage to the Union Jack when Roger skied off the cliff, you know. But he didn't go for it, sadly. But yeah, that was sensational, you know.
See you back at the lodge.
What's been the best Bond stunt that you personally have done?
I didn't do that many, really. I've been directing more than anything, you know. It's can't even think what I did in any of them. Not really. It's on the film we can't mention.
Well, let's talk about that, the horse jump.
That was good, yeah.
It was good. Actually, you jump off on an actual horse and land
into the
water.
They made me take that out of the movie, of course. There's a picture of it here somewhere. Yeah. It's up there somewhere. That's up there on the
top
there.
Yeah.
I only saw, actually, when I was in New Zealand last year on Lord of the Rings, somebody showed me the next part of that shot where we hit the water. It's pretty horrific, actually. But anyway, so they took that out of the movie because it looked a bit too violent. That was pretty scary. It was scary, you know, because you're sitting on the horse and you've got about 40-odd feet to go, and you're in this horse in this little starting stall, as it were, and then it tilts forward, and the door opens, and out you go, and you drop down. But this thing had followed me around the world, because we were doing the picture, and we were going to do it in the Bahamas. We built two in the Bahamas, I think it was. Which started thinking about building them, but you couldn't find anywhere with deep enough water, because you had deep enough water for the horse to go in, but also shallow enough for him to come back out again, so we needed a ramp. Solid base to build that great tower, because it's a huge construction. They did build one at one of the islands in the Bahamas, and they tested it with some rocks half the way to the horse, and the whole box and everything came off, so they built it with local people, labour, so that wasn't going to work, that would have killed us, you know. And in the end, it was one of the last things we did, and we shot it down at a marina in Agua Dulce in Spain, down Real Maria. But I was living in apartments. It was a golfing hotel, so we were playing golf in the evenings and everything else after work. But all you could see was this clunk, clunk, clunk. And I always equated it with the old westerns where the guy's in jail and he looks out the window and they're building the scaffold for him to hang him, you know? And every day he looks out and, yeah, his doom is getting bigger and bigger. And all I could see was this bloody tower getting taller and taller and taller. I'm thinking, it's going to be a long drop. And in the end, the day came. Okay, we're going to do it. We had a big ramp up to the top. Tracy Edden was doing the jump with me. And we get on. It's all on. It's go, 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 go. So we've got our wetsuits on. We're all there. And we get the horse up to the top. We get him in the box. There's cameras above and cameras to the side. And they're the big old BNCs and all that one. So they're running up to speed, you hear them go, you get up to speed, and the tension's up, tension up, and you're waiting for the action. And then you hear, cut, 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 cut. What? And old Paul Beeson, the DP, looking at, got his pan glass, looking at the sun, saying, no, it's going to go behind a cloud. And they wanted his son for the shot. So then the cloud came in, and we waited, like, sitting up there, sweating your watsits off, waiting. And then in the end, they say, no, it's a wrap, guys. We're not going to do it today. So it's another week before we do it. And you're like, stupid little things, but they're fun things to do. And there's a lot of better stunts than I've done in the Bonds. Even talking about Tracy Michaels, her husband, Wayne Michaels, did also what I think is one of the almost the best stunts in a Bond was the dive off the the dam. I had dinner with him the other night, funnily enough, and her, was while Wendy was in America, and talking about it, and that took some cojones, my God. It's just unbelievable. And but the presence of mind when he held it all the way down, all the way down, all the way down, all the way down, to get the gun out and fired it on the, you know, most people would be in jelly mould by the time they got to the bottom. It was just sensational, I think. But the amazing thing was, he said to me, before he did it, he was scouting, looking, and there was a little box sticking out on the bottom of the, near the bottom of the dam, and walking around looking. He wanted to go up and look at this box, couldn't understand what it was doing there, and it was something to do with the electrics, because whatever it was an obstruction. He just wanted to make sure there was plenty of room, but you know, you double check, you treble check. And he's on the top of this box. He told me himself years ago, and you could see him printed in the box, Levi studs pattern, of a Levi jeans embedded in it, where somebody's committed suicide off the top and hit this box so hard, embedded in this thing. And I said to him at the time, God, dear, oh dear, didn't your heart sink? He said, no. He said, I just felt incredibly sad. I'm standing on this place where this guy wanted to end everything. He said, it was just so sad that what must be going through this poor man's mind. I said, God. I'd have been having a heart attack.
His jeans.
Yeah, yeah.
So is there anything that you won't do? What are you scared of? Is it water, spiders, fire?
Snakes.
What will you absolutely refuse to do?
It's never a case of refusing it because of that I can think of. Fire I don't like, because it's so instant. One hiccup and you burnt your lungs, you know. I hate that, but everything, our job is to control all of that stuff. We do it, and our job is to break it down so it is repeatable. It's not, you know, because stunts aren't just walking onto the edge of a cliff and saying, take a deep breath, run and jump. You know, it's all calculated. You know, where you're going to go, how you're going to land. You've tested the water. You know, how fast you're going to be going when you hit the water and stuff like that. It's all worked out because you might have to do it 3, 4, 5 times. You know, I built the fan descender because of a situation like that. Got me going on it. We're doing a picture in Greece called Escaped Athena, and the director said to me, I want these opening sequence, and it's Space Cam, before the West Cam came out, the original Space Cam, this was, which is a dome on the front of a helicopter stabilizer. We want this resistance guy, Greek resistance, running along. We come up the cliff face, find him running, follow him. He goes along, he's chased by these Germans, and he goes across this bridge and jumps off the bridge into this canal. And we're in England talking about this, and it's the Corinth Canal. I said, how high is that? He said, 50, 60 feet, 70 feet. I went, okay. I didn't quite believe him anyway. I came home, looked it up, and it's like 450 feet. So you can't fall 450 feet. So I started working out how we would do it. We could build a platform underneath the bridge, 40, 50 feet down, have a camera on that, so you'd see him run on the bridge, jump and dive 40, 50 feet. Then you could drop a dummy for about 120 feet or so. You could lower a man on a wire and have him launch, so you'd have joining them all together, he'd fall 450 feet. He could do 120 into the water, even if he's a good diver. So he wouldn't have that. And then he said, well, we could have a boat sailing underneath it, because they built the Corinth Canal to cut off this huge leg of land where a boat can go through. So you get these huge liners going through it. He said he could land on a boat. And I said, I don't know. Anyway, we weren't going to do it. And in the end, we shot the movie, did everything else, didn't hear anything more about this Corinth Canal business. We then go to Athens mainland, because we're in Rhodes, Athens mainland, and we're driving around, and suddenly I'm at the Corinth Canal with the same director. He went, are you sure you can't do this? I went, George, I've offered every suggestion. A man cannot do it. And he said, I've got an answer, though. He could do it. He could have stolen a German helmet. put the helmet on. We're not in the same wavelength. Yeah, no. Like, that's going to save him 450 feet. Yeah, sure. And I said to him, look, you might get some lunatic from a lunatic asylum to jump in there, but you'd be done for manslaughter. Anyway, I stormed off, sat at this cafe, and I ordered a coffee, that Greek coffee. I was stirring it. Oh, damn it. You have to wait 10 minutes for all the stuff to settle down. Anyway, I'm sitting there like that, and he come and sat next to me, and he went, you all right? I went, yeah. To the, you know, he's not all friendly again. He said, I wouldn't. I said, well, you wouldn't what? He said, I've talked to the police. They wouldn't do me for manslaughter. So they're the sort of things you won't do, you know. So,
yeah.
But then that got me thinking. I did another picture for the same company. It was Lou Gray's outfit in Mexico called Green Ice. And we had to jump off this 400-foot building there. And they said, you have to come up with a device, Vic, that we can use in a movie that's never been in a movie before. Simple enough to be used by anybody without any exterior, you know, not rocket science or anything else like that. Could be built in the back streets of Bogota, which is where we're supposed to be, in a bicycle shop. Light enough to go up in a one-man hot air balloon. Mustn't be special effects and Bondy and, you know, jokes. It's actually going to be practical. We want to film it as well. It's going to be practical. Oh, that'll take me 2 or 3 minutes to invent that. Mm. So I came home and asked. Came up with the fan descender, which was a military device for creating the same speed hitting the ground in the parachute drop as a parachutist does. So I took that and revamped it and changed it around, and we used a fan descender for that. And so, you know, initially you'd say, I can't do a 450-foot fall, but there are ways to do things. So you never say no. You say, well, I can't do it that way, but I can adapt it for this, adapt it for that. And there are people who are specialists at what they do. You know, the high dive, I wouldn't do a high dive from 120 feet because I can't dive that high, you know, 10 foot's my max, and things like that. So you have to know your limitations, but there are hundreds of people out there that do have those qualifications and things, and if not, then you work out a way of doing it. But you never say no to a director. There's always a way of doing something. Okay. You can break it down and give them an alternative.
Yeah. Your father-in-law is George Leach, legendary Bond stuntman. Your good lady wife is also a stunt performer. Have you ever had to walk away when they've been doing a stunt thinking, I can't watch this?
I've hated it for a long time, even, you know, because it's not only that, my brother does what I do, and he's a stuntman. His son James is a stuntman. He's a stunt coordinator on Walking Dead. He's actually directing episodes of it now. He did his first one last week, the main episode. My son, Scott, is a stuntman. He's done the last six with Tom Cruise, assistant stunt coordinator and stuntman. My other son, Bruce, he's doing all Ridley Scott stuff. He does special effects, although he's one of the best drivers I've ever seen. He's a fantastic driver, but he prefers building machinery and all that sort of stuff. And then both daughters, Nina and Georgina, are stunt women. Nina's working on something at Leaves at the moment. She said she came in last night. They've been drowning in some tank somewhere. So the whole family are in it. So when I did Green Ice, it was horrendous. I said at the time, I'm sure I wasn't grey when I started the movie, because the first sort of action on the stunt chase I did on Green Hornet was my brother Andy doing a cannon roll. So it means a car goes down the road, explosive device comes out underneath, fires a log into the ground, and because the ground's solid, the device it's come out of moves. So it fires a car over and does a barrel roll. It's called a cannon turnover. My brother did that one. And then the next night, Scott, my son, had to do a head-on in a pickup which is on fire in through the front of a bus and out the top of the bus. That was a really violent one. But as fate would have it, we would try and keep advancing our business, and we decided, because his truck was on fire, we'd put a fire suppressor unit in it, like having Formula One cars. And we had great engineers who would do all our roll cages and build the pods, which are little round balls, very reinforced. We have like half a gallon of petrol in, just enough to do the stunt with, which, you know, which won't break or anything. Anyway, they put a fire suppressant kit in this pickup truck, and they come and do the stunt. It's a hell of a violent stunt. As it goes up the ramp, it hits a T-bar at the end of the ramp, which spins the truck round and throws it down the road. Anyway, it slid down the road on fire. And the next thing, this blooming tank that nobody'd ever seen one break before split. And so you got half a gallon of fuel, which is a lot of petrol, went into the cab. And luckily enough, Scott was conscious and he hit the button, and put the fire suppressant on. But it's the first time I ever put one in, so is that fatal?
Oh, lucky.
Incredible.
Oh,
incredible.
So that was the second stunt, and then the third night was James, my nephew, who's directing in Walking Dead now. He had to do an end-over cannon with a pickup truck, which is a very violent hit. So yeah, I hate it, but you're on the set and you're all there and you're not supposed to let anybody know, and it's okay, and roll cameras and action, and really you want to go, action!
So what about CGI? How has that changed the stunt game? For better or for worse, or is there good bits and is there a good and bad side to it?
In some ways it's changed it for the worse, but the good side is it's a fantastic, fantastic device when you really need it.
Yeah.
I think, I still think people use it too much. They tend to set an action up knowing they're going to have a telehandler there and a telehandler there and cables here and pulleys there and pads on the floor and all that will be erased in post, which I think is the wrong way to go about it. You know, whenever I set anything up, I try and set it up as though it's going to be all in camera, and then you get down to the common denominator where it can't be. So, okay, we'll cheat and do that. If we can't change angles on the camera, then we'll have to have something there for that. And da, 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 da. I think people just take it as a given that will be, you know, they'll be able to have all these add-ons that you can erase afterwards, which all cost money. You know, nothing's done for free, any of that. It sounds all right on the day, but it's going to cost a lot of money down the line. And I think some sequences don't get finished maybe because of that. But on the other hand, it is a fantastic lifesaver. When we were flying on Superman, we were on, Wendy and I were just on little piano wires, tiny little single strand piano wires. And when one snapped, the other one went straight away anyway. They couldn't take the extra load. And you know, you used to have some accidents on that. Whereas nowadays you can fly a Tech 12 as thick as your finger, which you could pull a tank with. You know, it's incredibly safe, but accidents still happen. It's a wonderful thing, CGI, and I'm quoted lots of times as saying it. To me, it's like a drug. It's like a morphine. Morphine used for the correct quantity for the correct ailment is an absolute godsend. Used and abused and overused, it's a killer. And it's a strange analogy, but that is CG for me as well. And you know, I'm on a huge CG project at the moment, The Power of the Rings, and I still go into it as if I'm going to shoot it for real, you know, because no matter how big the film is, every CG shot is going to be $100,000 plus, you know, no matter what it is. So you do feel due diligence, you have to do it, and that's the way I brought up, and that's why I like to do it, and I think it keeps it more real, so I try and keep everything realistic, and all right, we take reality and stretch it 15-20% maybe, because it is what it is, but it's a movie. But I think it's a good grounding to go in on. And to answer your question without waffling again, I think CG is wonderful, used in the right places for the right time. And there's some terrible CG as well, which, you know, can ruin a movie.
On that, and everybody will be remiss if we don't ask, do you wish you actually cut the iceberg in half on Die Another Day and let Brosnan paraglide properly?
Oh God, don't mention that one. I wish they'd cut it completely.
Because all of that build up to that section, the direction you did, car chase, everything was just superb.
We were all mortified.
Yeah.
We couldn't believe it made it to the final cut.
I think it was one of the first times Bond had ever used CGI, because otherwise it's all done for real point.
That predominantly, it was
horrendous. I think that knocks, people's...
I know.
Because Dying of the Day is the party Bond. It's the 40th anniversary, and it should be all fun. Yeah. And it's just that 30 seconds that probably knocked that film for six, in all fairness.
I looked at the other day, the ice up in you know, again, I'm so lucky with weather, you know. I got up there and the sun came out, and my driver, same age as me, he'd lived there his whole life, 65 years, whatever it was, and he hadn't seen more than 3 consecutive days of sunshine. And when I arrived, the sun came out, and we shot and shot and shot and shot and shot and shot. And then I went up onto the glacier to do a bit of the ice machine thing on the glacier for 2 days, and came back and you couldn't even walk on the ice, and I had all the cars, and so I'm so lucky. But no, I'm mortified when I saw that. It just makes a mockery of the whole thing, and we still shiver when we look at it. Because it was great stuff otherwise. Yeah, it was a great one.
It was fantastic. You know? The Vanquish was superb.
Yeah.
The smashing through the ice palace when you came out of it at the end. Everything was just great on that front. And it's that to me, because I love Bond, obviously. But that's the last of the classics, I always think.
Yeah.
And Daniel's come along with the new series and everything has changed.
But they are different.
That was the last classic, and it was the party Bond, I always think.
Yeah. Casino Royale was getting back to Dr. No and,
yes. yeah.
and good. Yeah. I really, yeah. really enjoyed that. I thought yeah. that was great. Fantastic movie. You know, from the get-go, just grabbed you. And but they are different now. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Quite right. But it's like getting old. Everybody else is getting old except me.
Oh, yeah. Now just looking at the photographs behind, you've worked on some iconic series. You've worked on Bond, you've worked on Mission Impossible, you've worked on Rambo, you've worked on Star Wars.
Indiana Jones.
And the big one's obviously Indiana Jones. And obviously Superman as well.
Yeah.
What's it like making Harrison Ford shine the way you did with all the work you've done?
It's a double act with old Harrison. He's the best, you know, no question. He's fantastic. He was here a couple of months ago and we were sitting there, just him, me and Wendy, having some nice poached salmon and some cauliflower cheese, which he loved, and sitting there talking about the old days.
Yeah.
It was really, really lovely. And he's a man, you know, and we work as a team. It's just like working with a stunt team, you know, but he's fastidious, you know, he's no mug. Everything's got to be right. And so he and I would work our fights out. He doesn't like throwing a left and things like that, things I know about him. And he wants to do everything, and he's capable of doing everything, but it's just, you know, it's not practical. If you bash his eye or get a broken nose or lose a tooth, there's, you know, it's huge consequences. And he sensibly knows that. But he was great, and obviously that was in the old days, the first three. And I came out of retirement to do the third one because I thought they were going to do three. And I wanted to definitely do the stunt coordinator and his double in all three movies. I was so proud of them. They were iconic movies, and they changed the face of action movies, you know. They really did. And they've been often imitated, never equaled, you know, in my opinion. But Harrison is the best, he's fabulous, and it's a team effort, and then we go to Steven and show him what we're going to fight, what we're going to do, what the suggestions are. But no, we watch each other's backs, and again, you couldn't get a better guy.
Because you've mentioned fate a bit, how your career's gone out. You did look ridiculously like Harrison Ford, and apparently people kept getting you mixed up because you look so alike.
Yeah.
That must be a fate.
He's let himself go, though, hasn't he, recently? that's the downside.
I was choked when he came here. He looked so fit and well.
Oh.
I felt like Jabba the Hutt. But no, when I first met Spielberg, I didn't do the bit in the snake pit and all that because I was in Mexico with Ryan O'Neill. Wendy did it. She did all the crashing down with all the snakes and all that stuff and Harrison. But years before that, my brother Andy did Force 10 from Navarone.
Oh, yeah.
And he called me one day. He was an assistant director before he went full-time stunts, Andy. He said, Vic, there's a guy on this movie. He said, he looks just like you. He said, he's great. So you want to keep an eye on him. If he gets successful, he said, you'd be a great double for him. And oh, good. Told me his name, Harrison Ford, and I completely forgot it. And then somebody did Hanover Street. And by then they said, this guy looks just like you, you know. Anyway, so then I'm in Mexico and Dave Tomlin, the first AD who did Superman, Bridge Too Far, a lot of big movies, fantastic AD. He kept calling and said, come on, when are you going to get over here? We've got this guy, you're a ringer for him. We're going to get you out here. So eventually I flew straight from Mexico to Tunisia, hit the ground running, got up at 3 a.m, got on the set. And they used to wrap it. It's so hot in Tunisia. They'd wrap about 11 o'clock and have some lunch. And you would wrap the whole movie by 3 because it was so hot. So I'm there, see all my stunt buddies, Peter Diamond and all the boys are there. And my first day on the set, and I got blue shorts and a white T-shirt on. And they said, come on, let's slope off now. We get some lunch before the mob, as we call them, before they wrap the unit, before the mob arrives. So I'm walking along. And somebody said, Harrison, I'm with the boys chattering away. And then somebody grabbed my arm, and what? And he went, and it was Spielberg. And he said, you're not Harrison. I said, no, I'm not. Who are you then? I said, I'm Vic Armstrong. Said, what are you doing here? I said, I'm a stuntman, I've just arrived. And he went, David, look, this guy's, he looks just like Harrison. And Dave said, that's the guy I've been telling you about. He's coming, right. He's just arrived. So that was the first time I met him. So, you know, the film went on and on and on. And, you know, some pictures there. I did look a lot like him in those days. I remember walking along one day and a little hand grabbed my finger and I'm walking along down. It's his kid walking.
Oh, really?
Holding the hand like that. Until I spoke, you know,
That's quite a nice, one of the best looking men in Hollywood to be compared to Luke. That's quite a nice compliment. Could be worse, couldn't it?
Fantastic. No, you can't say anything too good about Harrison. He's the best.
You didn't fancy doing number five?
Never got offered it.
Oh!
Never got offered it. I'm happy, though, with what I did. And I think we did the three iconic ones with Stephen, Harrison, George, everybody was involved, and it was a communal, everybody literally was involved, from Dave Tomlin to Kathy Kennedy. On the first one, she was like a PA, but, you know, very smart cookie, and Frank Marshall, and, you know, everybody had contributions to it, sensible contributions, and it was, you know, it was a wonderful progression. When you think about it, the first time we did it, we didn't know what we're making, it's just another movie, you know. And I've said it before, and I heard Stephen shout to Les Dilly, the art director, who's dusting down one of the cars, come on, Les, get a move on, it's a B-movie, come on, we don't have time for that. Called it the B-movie itself. So we didn't know what that was going to be, and then, of course, you go and watch your movie, and it's absolutely breathtaking. And then we do the Temple of Doom, and now we're getting into the swing of things. And then Last Crusade, by now, you know, the clothes fit, and we're all comfortable in our own skins, and it's the same crew, the same everything, and the creativity, and wonderful experience being able to be. So again, it was fate that I was at the peak of my ability, looking like I did in those days, for that, for Superman, and then later on for my Bond stuff, you know? So it was, I was just around at the right time, you know, and you can't buy that sort of luck, you know?
And what about, what's left then? Is there any ambitions you haven't done? Is there a director you want to work with, a particular franchise you want to work with, actors you want to work with, or a genre of film you want to do? What's left for you that you haven't done, if anything?
There's not a lot I really want to do. I'm not wild about the way the business is changing and things like that. It's not the theatrical business it was. It's more of a production, refrigerator-making business at the moment type of thing. I've directed my movies. Good, Bad and Indifferent, Joshua Tree and Left Behind. It made 40 million, so it's a good movie. Sunday Horse, which is a labour of love for my daughter, who loves show jumping, and that's a fabulous movie. You know, it's a really well-made movie, I say myself. I directed Young Indiana Jones. So I've done my directing, I've done that, got that ego trip out of the way, and thoroughly enjoyed it. And I've enjoyed all my second units and stuff like that, and I don't really want to do a lot more. I'm quite happy with all the people I work with are fantastic, from Scorsese to Verhoeven to Spielberg, and all the way down the line, you know, there's and some great movies as well, some great adventures around the world, from The Mission, you know, down in South America, and there were adventures, you know, we'd walk 3 or 4 kilometers to work, everybody carrying a camera box or something, and you get there and you shoot the movie and you walk all the way back in blistering heat and humidity with mud caking up on your feet, but it's an adventure.
Yeah.
Absolute adventure, and you feel you've created something at the end of the day, you know, and one of the most beautiful films ever made, I think, The Mission. It's gorgeous, you know. It's funny how things go around. I'm out in New Zealand, I'm rambling now, in New Zealand, and Jay Biona, the Spanish director of Penny Dreadful that I work with on in Ireland, he's directing the prime episode of the Lord of the Rings out there, The Power of the Rings. And there's a waterfall climbing sequence in the opening sequence. I did all the prologue of it, that shot all that stuff, and I had to shoot this sequence on a waterfall. And he's got the storyboards of the waterfall, and it's a frozen waterfall. And he starts telling me, he said, yeah, there's this fantastic film I saw, and I had this waterfall in the background, and I've just taken that, and we're going to shoot it like that, and it's all ice. I said, Jay, I did that. I was on the mission there. Oh, my God, really? So funny, yeah. So you've gone the full circle now, you know, from a hot waterfall in South America, a frozen waterfall in New Zealand. Now I've done all I want to do, really. Yeah. If there's an exciting job comes up and a good location, I'd be thrilled to do it. It's not that I'm getting blasé about it, but unless I really want to enjoy it and go somewhere nice, I wouldn't break my heart if I didn't get a call, you know.
You got anything left?
I've got a couple of things. Yeah. What fits you better? The red cape, the fedora and the bullwhip, or the dinner jacket?
Sadly, about the bullwhips, about the only thing, because it doesn't have to go on my body. I wouldn't put that on, I know. my little granddaughter came in and she had a Supergirl thing on. I showed her that one. She said, oh, put that on, Granddad, and we'll take pictures together.
Yes, so, yeah.
Oh, we'll get one leg in there. The fedora, funny enough, hats always shrink. You can see it in a little while. They do tend to shrink. I do love my fedora, and I love the hat. The whip is beautiful, and the DJ doesn't really suit me.
Well, funnily enough, the last thing is I was in Disney last year, and funnily enough, I actually bought one of these. And I wonder, can you still crack the whip?
You wouldn't crack this one.
No, I know you wouldn't. It's the Indiana Jones one from Disney, but you've got the real one.
Can you still crack it? Yeah.
Oh, you can have to demonstrate off camera though.
How funny!
Yeah. They sell the fedora and the whip, and I thought I got to buy one of those because you've been part of my childhood and my adulthood because Superman was the first adventure sort of film that we ever saw. And then obviously we got into Bond and then Indiana Jones. So all I can do is thank you for everything you've done with my misspent youth.
I went to the Disneyland with my grandson when he was about 9 or something, and we'd be on the Indiana Jones ride, and we're lining up. He said, what happens on this one then, Grandad? I don't know. Of course you do, you did the movie. Out loud, so everybody can hear.
Stunt performers going to like the directing side, have you done that progression? I'm guessing you mentioned Bob Simmons. Who's helped you make that progression? Is there people that have really taught you or have you really learned from to do that?
The directors mainly, following them, and then I got support from people that actually employ you. That's the hardest job, is getting the job. But no, I always wanted to do that. As you say, it's a natural progression from a stunt man. I used to see the stunt coordinator. That's a better job because he's telling me what to do and he's got creative. He's advising this and that and the other. And then the second unit director would come on and he's actually creating the shots and things like that. And then, of course, the main director runs everything. So I wanted to be the main director, which, as I said earlier, I've done. So it is a natural progression, but it's the creativity I like. You know, I sit down and I can visualize things and being able to break them down, then put your money where your mouth is. It's all right coming up with an idea and how you do this and how you do that sequence-wise, but then you have to break it down. How do you actually photograph it for the audience to see it and safely and everything else? So it's a huge undertaking. So I learned a lot from directors, as I say. Hal Needham, who wrote and directed Smokey the Bandit and all those films, he's a buddy of mine. Him and me over there playing golf. Watched him. I went down to Vegas with him when he was doing Cannibal Run 2. We were going to do Terry and the Pirates in Thailand, and he flew me down to Vegas. He said, come on down there for the weekend and see me. There's a shoot down there, which is great. But watching him shoot, and I don't know, it's just every little bit you pick up along the way. And I think it's wanting to do it. It's a hard job, actually, second unit, because you are second fiddle. You know, you have to do what the director wants. And as Scorsese said, Vic's great, he does exactly what I want, and then he'll do his own version, sometimes you like that better, you know, or not. But you have to stay within parameters and things, so it's not like just going out there and doing whatever you want to do. It's quite a politically delicate thing to do as well, but very creative, and I love the end result. I mean, there's nothing like going to a Bond or wherever, or, you know, seeing the trailers and seeing 80% of your stuff in the trailers, because that's what put bums on seats, you know. So not a lot of people do it, but I think more and more and more are now, because when I started, nobody did it. No stunt people did it in England. And people look at me and say, you're directing second unit? Because normally it was editors or somebody like that stepped up and did it. But nowadays, it's taken, I think, for granted. If you're a stunt coordinator, then you direct second unit as well, which is not always the case, because it is quite a different job, actually directing what's going in the lens as to how you are physically going to do the job, which a coordinator does. So there's quite a lot of difference in it, but, you know, it's not brain surgery if I can do it anyway.
Well, Vic, it's been fascinating listening to your career, your stories about your career. If you enjoyed this interview, please donate what you can. Anything counts, a bit of spare change to Richard House Children's Hospice. I'll put the link on the article. Vic Armstrong, thank you very much.
It's been my honour, and I congratulate you and compliment you on all this work for the charity.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thing. And, please do that, folks, because I don't do these interviews at all. But when Joe told me about this, I stepped up and did it, and I'm very pleased to be able to do it. So great. Please that's give generously if you can.
Anything counts, yeah. Let's hope we raise a few pod. Thank you, Vic.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Philip.